Good morning, Bethel. Stand up to your feet. And let's worship Jesus. Put your hands together.
When the doubt in my way tries to steal what you've saved, saying I have no reason to praise, I will give thanks. I will give thanks. When the roar that I hear is the voice of my fear, trying to silence this hope in my heart, I will give thanks. Yes, I will give thanks.
Come on.
A song of thanksgiving is my battle cry. With joy as my weapon, I stand and defy the lie of the dark with my hands lifted to the sky.
Here we go.
I will rejoice. I will rejoice. Your name, whoa, I'll speak your name.
We gotta speak his name.
A song of thanksgiving is my battle cry. With joy as my weapon, I'll stand and defy this lie of the dark with my hands lifted to the sky.
Wandering into the night,
place to hide this weary soul. These bad bones. And I try with all my might, I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, this vagabond. And just when I choice but to believe. My doubts are burning like ashes in the wind. So, so long to my old friends. Burning in bitterness, you can't just keep it moving. No, you're not welcome here. From now
Bethel, it's so good to see you in the house of God. This is church, and this is why we come here. This is why we're alive. It's all because of Him. And so I want to welcome you. I want to welcome Bethel Saratoga, our northern campus. And I just want to say that God is in this room today. He's here moving. He's here having His way. And won't you join me in opening up our hearts to let the King of Glory come in? Father, we love you and we thank you. We praise you for who you are, for what you've done. I pray, Father, that you would be Lord of this place today. Be Lord of our hearts. Open up the floodgates of heaven and let the King of Glory come down in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's worship.
Savior's love through the storm.
Hallelujah. You may be seated.
We see the story of Jesus going to the cross, and everything seems to kind of be hand in hand. And then there's this one character that seems to interrupt the narrative. His name's Barabbas. We don't even know much about him except that he's a murderer, a leader of an insurrection, a rebel. And why he's even mentioned, sometimes I'm not so sure. It's like, what? This is about Jesus going to the cross. So in this moment, Pilate thinks, I hold the destinies of these two men in my hand. I know the Jews have a tradition that on a holy day, I will release one of the prisoners on death row. Pilate stands on this audacious stage, who now presents Jesus, Son of the Living God, versus Barabbas, the thug and rebel. He says, all right, who do you want? This is blasphemy. This has gone too far. There's no comparison. This is a rightful prisoner, a man who should be on death row. He's a rebel against Rome. He leads a rebellion. He murders people. He's a bad man. He's a thug and he's a crook. He deserves the chains and he deserves the crucifixion. Jesus, what has he done but heal, restore, deliver, set free, open blind eyes, open deaf ears, heal the lame and the leper? What has Jesus done? Who do you want? We want Barabbas. Yeah, give us Barabbas. People say, give us Barabbas. The Roman soldiers come up and they put the key in and they unlock Barabbas from his chains and shackles. And he walks down the platform, welcomed by all of his thug friends. Yeah, the people love me. Yeah, that's right. I don't even know who this Jesus guy is, but all I know is my people love me. There seems to be no conscience in Barabbas. There's no record of him turning to Jesus and saying, I owe you everything now, for you have set me free. No, I don't see any of that in Barabbas. God knew that. Jesus stood there, silent, for he knew the will of the Father. He said, it's fine, Father. Let him have Barabbas. For Jesus knew that the Father would have to treat Jesus like Barabbas so he could treat Barabbas like Jesus. Barabbas thought it was the people that set him free. No, 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 no. It was the love of the Heavenly Father. When I look at the story, I realize who Barabbas really is. That's me. That's you. That's us. And I felt, I was reading this the other day, and I felt God speak to me. I love Barabbas. I love him. But God, he's a bad man. I love him. And I wanted him to go free. But didn't you know that he probably would have never acknowledged the free gift. Yeah, but I love Barabbas. For while we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
What a powerful reminder for us this morning as we prepare to partake of communion. Not only who Jesus is, but who we are. We deserve nothing. And he gives us his love and his grace. If you're here this morning and you're a follower of Jesus Christ, we want to invite you to take communion with us today. The ushers are coming down. And if you need the elements, if you didn't grab it on your way in, go ahead and grab one of those. And we're going to partake of communion together. And this is our remembering the price that Jesus paid for our sin, for you and I, for Barabbas. How Jesus went to the cross and he endured it so you and I can have our sins forgiven, so we can have a relationship with the Heavenly Father, so we can spend eternity with him. Jesus paid the price. And it doesn't matter how bad you are, you need the blood of Jesus. It doesn't matter how good you think you are, you need the blood of Jesus. It's only by his sacrifice. So let's honor him with that this morning. Scripture tells us on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you." Let's partake of the body of Christ together. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. Scripture says on the same night he took the cup, he gave it to his disciples. He said, "Take, drink, this is my blood, the blood of the new covenant. And as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death." You remember the Lord's death till he comes. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your precious blood that was shed. This cup is a reminder to us this morning, the price that you paid, just how much you loved us. Even though we were sinful, even though we're enemies of the cross, Jesus, you came and you suffered, and you shed your perfect blood for our forgiveness, for our ransom. Lord, we thank you for your tremendous sacrifice. And Lord, let the gravity of this moment just weigh on our hearts today as we recognize the price that you paid to have a relationship with us. We thank you, Heavenly Father. Let's partake of the cup together and let's stand as we continue to worship.
I don't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. It's so true, yes it is, yes it is. I know that you're working.
Just hang on to that for a moment. Father, we love you. And we thank you, God, for the words of this song. They're true. There's times when we can't feel your working. There's times when we don't know why you've left us, but I thank you that you've never walked away from us. I thank you that even when we didn't know you, you were right there. And all it took is one step to you. I thank you, God, that there's times when we can't feel it. But Lord, we can trust in your word and your promise that you won't leave us or forsake us, that you're always working. You're always moving. Because that is who you are. We may change, but you never do. You never change. He's so good. He never, ever changes. And so, Father, we pray, Father, that you would just open up the floodgates and let your Holy Spirit come down, minister to us. Remind us today that you're unwavering. Remind us today that you're the cornerstone. Remind us today that you're the anchor that we hold to. In Jesus' name, we love you. We thank you. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated.
Good morning and welcome to Bethel. We're so glad that you decided to come check us out this morning. So we ask that you would go to our welcome desk in the foyer to receive your free gift bag. In addition to that, please text Bethel Guest to 94,000 so that we can better connect with you and welcome you here to our church.
December 5th, after each service, we'll be having ministry fair in the foyer. All the tables will be set up for each one of our ministries. Go and check them out and see where you can get involved in serving.
Thank you to everyone who's been faithfully giving this past year. Offering buckets are located in the back of the sanctuary.
There are four more easy ways to give and honor God with your finances.
You can mail a check to 3669 Gilderland Ave, Schenectady, New York, 12306.
Give on our website or send a text to 84321 or give on the Church Center app.
Good morning, church. Glad that you are here. Hope you are enjoying your Sunday morning. So we got a couple announcements before we jump into the word this morning. It's Christmas season. We got a few things to hit. But first and foremost, it is December in upstate New York. Yay. It is also cold and flu season. We've also had a pandemic. I don't know if anybody's heard about that. There's this corona thing. In any case, this is your seasonal reminder. If you have a cough, if you have a sniffle, if you're feeling a little under the weather, but I'm sure it's nothing. For the love of God, stay home. praise God, we've done very well through this. We've had several people who have battled with COVID. We know this thing is real, but we're thankful that nobody spread it in the church. So please, please, please continue to be careful, to use caution, and we appreciate that. Also, another announcement, this one's way better. Our worship leader, Lori Bland, had her baby girl. Amen. So little Olivia was born. She weighed in at 27 pounds. And it just felt like that. 9 pounds. Olivia was born. So congratulations to Lori and Maddie. And she had the kid on like Thursday. I'm like, it's Sunday. Come to church, whatever. But in any case, be sure to congratulate them, and we're so happy for them. When you walked in today, hopefully you noticed the beautiful Christmas decorations. We want to thank everyone who came out yesterday and helped us put up trees and hang ornaments and clean afterwards and everything else. Special thanks to Mark Vanderpool. A lot of you don't know this, but Mark is part elf, and he really gets into Christmas, and he has an affinity for elf culture, all those good things. But Mark does an awesome job when it comes to decorating trees or overseeing them. So it looks great in here, and Mark, thank you for all that you do. When you walked in today, you passed on the back table some little invite cards, and our theme for all of this month and for the Christmas season is Hope is Born. And we've made up enough of these cards for every single one of you to take one and invite someone to join you for Christmas services, whether it's Christmas Sunday or Christmas Eve or anything that we have that's coming up. It's Christmas. Everyone goes to church on Christmas. Even your degenerate loser friends who would never go, they'll come on Christmas. So help me out. I want you to find someone and I want you to begin to pray for them. And I want you to pray for God to open up some doors for you to share your faith. And part of that is grabbing a card and invite them to join you for, don't just take a handful of cards and leave them at Bellevue. I'll do that, okay? Invite someone specific who you know needs the hope that only Jesus offers. And invite them to join you. So we'd appreciate that. Every Christmas, we do a couple different missions projects to bless some of our missionaries and to support some of the needs both locally and overseas. As you came in today, you got one of these offering envelopes called the Christmas offering. We've done this for the past several years. And the purpose of this offering, 100% goes to fund our orphanage in Haiti, His Work International or HWI. So pray this month you are in the spirit of giving, give an eternal gift. Pray as to what God would have you give. Drop it in this envelope or you can give online, throw it in the offering bucket and it will go to help support our work in Haiti. The other Christmas project that we're doing is we're collecting new unwrapped toys. So from, I don't know, birth until about 16, 17 years old. And we are going to distribute these toys both through our church plant, Bethel Northside, and we're also going to use it to supplement the outreach of the Schenectady City Mission. So instead of doing four or five little projects like we've done in the past, we're just going to do one. There's going to be a big wrapped box by the tree out there, and one unwrapped gift, $20-$25. Don't go showing up with like a plasma TV. Or like a new 80-inch 5K. I said plasma. I dated myself, didn't I? My bad. All right, leave it alone. Zip it, King. So in any case, $20-$25, bring it in, throw it under the tree. We'll make sure it gets to some kids in need. Last thing, you saw it when you walked in today. We have some tables set up out in the foyer for our ministry fair today. We do this every... We should probably do it more often than we do, but the last one we did was in the old building, to give you an idea. It takes probably this morning, 50 to 60 volunteers have been at work this morning to make Bethel, Bethel. So from the things that you see up here or maybe in the cafe or the ushers to the things you don't see going on in the back with our children's ministry or in the AV and the tech booth. Just all over the building today, there are volunteers who are making Bethel great. And let me just say this, they're doing a phenomenal job. Amen? They do a wonderful job. But we need you. There are many volunteers who are not attending or not serving through COVID and for whatever reason. We need you. So if you're here and you are not involved in a ministry, if you're here and you're not serving on a Sunday somewhere, this is for you. I will be standing at the door after service giving you a condescending glare as you leave. It's good. Listen, Catholics don't get all the guilt. We'll use a little. Okay. Really, take this opportunity, meet some new people, sign up. There is something spiritual for you when you serve, and then there is something very practical where you can meet a need. So it is absolutely win-win. Check that out on your way out today and stop at the cafe and buy one of those blueberry muffins to help support our missionaries. And they're so good, so good. I'm not going to say they're better than the service, but they're good. They're really good. All right, let's go ahead and we'll get to the Word of God. I told you our theme for the month is Hope is Born. And because of Jesus, you and I have hope. And we're going to talk a little bit today about that hope. Because our world needs, desperately needs the hope of Jesus. One of my children came home this week and they were complaining about gas prices. I had conflicting emotions as a father. One, yes, those gas prices are ridiculous. Two, I'm not paying for your gas, I don't care. Yes, they're older, it's wonderful. But listen, seriously, you watch a news cycle, spoiler alert, it's all bad. It's all negative. Everything we hear, you are constantly bombarded with just an avalanche of terrible news. From things in the political realm, whether it's high gas prices or bad job numbers or inflation. This week there was a school shooting, tragic. Last week, some guy drove his car through a parade. We're bombarded with bad news. Now we have the Omicron variant. When does it end? I was told by reliable sources, in 15 days we will slow the spread. It was 2 years ago. When's it over? Everything that we've heard for 2 years has been bad news. Church, we're talking about hope. Because our world today really desperately needs to see the hope of Jesus. Because there were people 2 years ago who were battling depression, and now 2 years later, they haven't left their house in 2 years, and they're way worse. And there were marriages that were holding on just by a thread, and then 2 years of negativity and stress, and we've all felt it. They're not doing so hot today. And our kids have dealt with it. They've watched all the same bad news, and then they heard us adults complaining about it. And they get moved from school to out of school to Zoom school to no, and they're feeling it. People whose lives had been set free from addiction went right back to the prison they were in. They turned right back to the drugs, to the alcohol, under this overwhelming mountain of stress and hurt. And it's been nonstop, and it's gone on for 2 years now, and things weren't perfect before then. Church, we have the hope of Jesus, and this world, like never before in our lifetimes, this world needs to know about how hope was born, and hope came to us. Jesus is our hope. And boy, do we need it. And this season becomes a ministry opportunity for us. This is a terrible crisis, but at the same time, for followers of Jesus, this is an opportunity. The fields are ready to be harvested. People need to know that there's hope. People need to know there's more to this life than just the garbage that fills their brain 24/7 on the news channels and in everything that's going on. People need to know about the hope that we have in Jesus. So we'll be talking about the hope of Christ all month long. I don't think this theme could be any more timely. Hope is born. Here's your definition of what hope is. It's the feeling of what is wanted can be obtained, or that events will turn out for the best. Hope, the idea that what is wanted can be obtained, or that events will turn out for the best. Do you still have hope? As Americans, do you have hope? As followers of Jesus, do you have hope that God is still working everything out? That we can still trust him and put our faith in him as people? Hope is in short supply. So today we're going to talk about two things. One, do we have hope? And secondly, what are we putting that hope in? What are we putting that hope in? If you have your Bible, we're gonna start our Christmas story several hundred years before Jesus is on the scene in the Old Testament. Our Christmas story begins hundreds of years earlier. It's prophesied throughout the pages of the Old Testament. The story of Jesus saturates the Bible. One scholar pointed to 574 different Old Testament verses that deal with or referenced or gave an example of the Messiah when he would come. So Jesus is there, cover to cover. And our Christmas story takes us all the way back to the time of Isaiah the prophet. Isaiah is prophesying to a nation that's in for a difficult time. Many of the prophets in the Bible had this same kind of message. None of them were well received. It's weird because the prophets today only talk about the blessings and the surplus and how great everything will be, but all the prophets in the Bible basically said, you haven't been following God and it's going to get ugly. And if you read through the Old Testament, that was the message, but then they followed that with, but Jesus is coming. And in Isaiah, we learn a great lesson, not only on who to put our hope in, but what our hope is actually and what that actually means when we talk about putting our hope, of course, in Jesus. So Isaiah pens through the guidance of the Holy Spirit, Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 through 7. Immediately to the north of Israel is Assyria. They are sweeping in like a flood. They are about to wipe out Israel, knock over the cities, take people captive. We've read the story before. Isaiah is prophesying this before it comes, but he wants the people to know a better day is coming. Isaiah 9, 1 through 7. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who are in distress. In the past, God humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future, he will honor Galilee of the nations by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light, and those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bars across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning. They'll be fuel for the fire. Why? Verse 6. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. And the zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. I was reading that this week of his government, the greatness of his government and his peace. There will be no end, no end to the peace that God speaks over us. The Jews were certainly hoping for their Messiah, the promised deliverer, to come. And this is what's called the messianic prophecy, a prophecy about the Messiah. We see in there the references to Jesus, who is coming. And we see also what the ministry of Jesus will entail. But what's not given to us clearly is the exact timeline that everything's going to happen. Isaiah's word of encouragement for people who are facing pending doom was something that was going to happen hundreds of years later, something that none of them would still be alive to see, because Isaiah wasn't simply referencing some physical event. He was looking beyond that, beyond the physical and beyond the temporary, and he was looking to the eternal. He was looking to the spiritual. One of their many enemies, the Assyrians, were coming to invade Israel. They were coming from the north, the lands in the north, Naphtali, Zebulun, Galilee, all to the north there. And this is what Isaiah references, where right now these places were going through a difficult time. But in the future, out of Galilee, a son's going to be born. A son's going to be given. And Isaiah references the advent, the coming of Christ. And before he finishes his prophecy, he's moved on to the second coming of Christ, which we have not seen yet. Isaiah is telling people in their present difficulties to have hope and take refuge, not in the fact of anything right now, but in what's to come and what God has in store. And this is the message of hope that we all so desperately need and that we all need to remember. The Jews had a problem. From Isaiah's day, even to some of the first followers of Jesus in the early church, they were guilty often of putting all their hope in the physical and the temporary. So the Jews knew all these prophecies about the Messiah that was going to come. And they were expectant for that Messiah. They were excited for that Messiah. But why? Because they believed when the Messiah came, he would overthrow the oppressive Assyrians or Babylonians or Medes and Persians or Romans. They had a few oppressors in their day. Because they believed that when the Messiah came, he would change the physical and everything here would be better and they'd be happy and no one would be stressed anymore and no one would be sick. We move forward into the time of Christ. They still thought this. In fact, when Jesus came, there were those in the crowd, it says they tried to make him king by force because they believed Jesus was going to overthrow the Romans and set up the kingdom of the Messiah and everything would be better. They were still thinking just about the here and now. Even after his resurrection, the disciples were so sure that Jesus was returning any minute. They sold everything they had. They moved in together. They were like, yes, he's coming. This is awesome. And then he didn't. And then it was just awkward. Throughout history, the Jews, humanity, we've messed this up where we've thought that the hope of Christ was in the here and now alone. And we forget the eternal. We forget the plan of God. Their mistake, and probably ours as well, is they attach the hope of the Messiah to their own physical expectations. And in doing so, they missed the entire point. This is the problem. It's a big problem in Christianity today. Just like the Jews, we've put so much hope in our physical reality, in that which is temporary. We've been deceived. We've bought the lie. We've listened to some false teachers and some bad teachers out there. And they told us when we have faith in Christ, everything in this world will be just fine. You won't have problems anymore. You won't have trials anymore. There'll be no issues. Tiny Tim, who lost the leg to polio, that's going to grow back. He's going to be good. Everything will be fine once you put your hope in Christ. You'll never have a problem in your marriage. Never have a problem with your kids. You'll never have a financial issue. And this is the garbage that has been preached for years, teaching people just like in Jesus' day, just like in Isaiah's day, that our hope is in the here and now and things here being all better and happy. But Jesus tells us a different story. And Christianity is filled with people who have come to Christ on this false notion that when you come to Jesus, everything will be perfect. And then guess what? It ain't perfect, folks. It's messy. Then they come to Christ and they realize that there's trials. They realize that this isn't all unicorns and rainbows. This world is hard. This life is hard. There's still sickness. There's still needs. There's still brokenness. There's still evil in the world today. Wait a minute. I was told all this goes away when I give my heart to Jesus. I don't have to worry about any of this anymore. But then the world slaps reality into our face and we realize that there's trouble and tribulation all around us, and Jesus never promised us freedom from it, but he said, I'll be there with you. And people leave the faith in droves because they put their hope in the wrong thing. People go back to drugs. People bail on their marriage and they leave their family. People quit because it got too hard. They leave the church. They leave the faith because everything for 2 years has been nothing but stress. And we believed the lie that the hope of Jesus meant we'd never be stressed. But we are. Because the hope of Jesus is much bigger than just a temporary physical reality. God has a much different idea about this. God has a very different perspective than man does when it comes to hope. We're often thinking about the here and now, what God could do for me today, how God could fix, fill in the blank. The situation that's giving you grief, the person that's giving you grief, the spouse that's giving you whatever your situation is. And God's gonna fix it. And then we have hope in Jesus, but the hope in Christ is so much more than that. So much more than the temporary, so much more than just the physical. As a result of this, some people tend to think that Jesus is just a means to an end. Some people have been lured to Christianity by preachers, by probably well-intentioned people who led them to Christianity with this idea, serve God, give your heart to Jesus, and all this other stuff will fall into line. I'm here to tell you today, give your heart to Jesus because he loves you and he died for you and he's the only way to the Father. And life with Jesus is infinitely better than life without Jesus, but it's still hard. But it's still hard. But there's still problems. But you never have to go through them alone. People who have viewed Jesus as a means to an end, they start to put their hope in these physical things. They hope in people. They hope in success or wealth. They hope in government, suckers. They hope in power. They hope in status. They hope in reputation. A lot of pride on this list. Hoping in ourselves. But then something happens. See, people will help us. Or we'll gain some success or wealth or things in government are going well or we have a little power or recognitions. We feel important. And in that moment, we say, oh, we're so blessed. But then when things start to fall apart, as soon as they get difficult, your faith is rocked. People drift. They fail. The love grows cold. They backslide. They run away. Their hope was in temporary results. Not an eternal treasure. The Word of God tells us about the hope that we have in Jesus, and it is not some get-rich-quick thing. It is not some pill you take and tomorrow everything is fine. It's about giving your life to the one who gave his life for you. And it's so much more than just the physical and the temporary. Hebrews 11:1, and we're going to reference Hebrews a couple times here this morning. Hebrews 11 is the faith chapter. It gives us a definition of faith and it goes on and it tells us all about the heroes of the faith. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is the assurance of things that are hoped for. And there seems to be this correlation between faith and hope. Faith is the assurance of the things hoped for, the English Standard Version tells us. Faith is built on the fact that we have hope in Jesus Christ. It's the assurance that that hope is real, that that hope is true. Hebrews 11 goes on and it lists what's called heroes of the faith. And you would think heroes of the faith, this is just going to be a long list of people whose lives were perfectly blessed and how everything went well for them because their hope was in Jesus. The first guy on the list is Abel. They're laughing because they know the story of Abel. Gets killed by his brother. Hits him with a rock probably. He takes his brother out. The first hero of the faith, I'm here to let you know, didn't go great for him. Not in this world, but in what was to come. And then Hebrews 11 goes on and it lists these heroes of the faith. And I want you to know, they all have a story. Noah, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, Rahab. We have a murderer in that group. We have a prostitute in that group. We have a drunk in that group. And the only good dude spent the most time in prison of anyone in that group. Joseph. These are not stories of trouble-free, carefree lives. These are not stories on how they never faced hardship or problems or adversity. It's just the opposite. They faced a ton of it. They faced loads of it. And most of them from the Old Testament lived never having seen the Messiah. Jesus doesn't come on the scene until 400 years after the Old Testament's wrapped up. They never saw Jesus. They just kept their faith in God despite all of life's hardships. And there's a verse in Hebrews where it says they weren't looking to this world. They were looking for a city with foundations whose builder and maker is God. They weren't thinking about the here and now. They were thinking about eternity. They were thinking about being with Jesus. Hebrews 11 continues. It says, time would fail to tell us of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets. The list goes on and on. These were not perfect lives. These were people who put their faith and hope in God, and their lives were filled with hardships. They had victories, yes, but they also suffered great defeats. But their hope was on more than just the physical. Their hope wasn't based on the here and now. Their hope was in God. Hebrews 11, 35 through 37 gives us this to wrap up the chapter of faith. Talks about some others. They don't even get names in the Bible, just others. Hebrews 11, 35, there were others who were tortured, who refusing to be released so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Verse 36, some faced jeers, flogging, even chains and imprisonment. Verse 37, they were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. Isaiah the prophet was sawn in half. That's how he died, prophesying for God. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute and persecuted and mistreated. These are our heroes, church. These are the ones that despite what was going on around them and despite what was happening to them, they did not let their faith in God, they did not let their hope in God waver, not even for a minute, because they kept their heart and their minds and their eyes on things above. I think one of the greatest things God can do for us today is change our perspective. And get us out of ourselves a little bit. Get us out of just this focus on the here and now. Get us out of this, well, this went poorly for me, so God's not real. This didn't go the way I planned, so God's not good. Or my parents messed this up, so God must not be that nice after all. And we take and choose the physical things and try to attach that attribute to God. Like, because of what happened in your life last week, God is suddenly less God. He's less powerful. He's less holy. He's less sovereign. This is the problem with so much of Christianity that is preached today. It's all based on how you feel and what happens to you today. But the truth is, Jesus is on the throne. Even if your week was garbage, Jesus is all powerful, even when you're sick. Jesus loves you deeply, even if your parents messed up. Like, none of these things change who God is or his tremendous love for us. But if we put our hope just in the here and now, we miss everything that Jesus came for, everything that he died for. And it's no wonder that throughout history, Christians, Jews, people who wanted to be followers of God were disillusioned because they thought following God meant no more problems. But that's never what Jesus promised us. The writer of Hebrews puts it this way. In Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19, he writes, "We have this hope as an anchor for our soul, firm and secure." Now, I don't know if you've done a lot of boating or if you're much of a fisherman or any of that kind of thing, but I know in Jesus' days, a lot of his disciples were fishermen and a lot of people in that region were fishermen, and they knew what it was to be on a boat, and they knew how important it was to have a good anchor, because one of the primary uses for the anchor would be when a storm would hit, they would drop the anchor and they would hope that the anchor held them from getting washed out to sea, blown off course by hundreds of miles with no GPS, or even worse, just destroyed in the winds and the waves. So that anchor in a storm was their lifeline. The writer of Hebrews knew this, and this is how he words it. He talks about our faith in Christ. He talks about our hope in Jesus. And he says, we have this hope as an anchor in the storm. You know what the anchor doesn't do? It doesn't stop the storm. The anchor doesn't stop the wind, the blowing, the rain, the waves. The anchor doesn't stop water from getting in the boat, you having to bail a little. The anchor doesn't stop damage that can be sustained in the storm. And maybe there's some things you have to fix and work on and clean up. And maybe your boat's not going to be the shape it was because that storm was a tough storm. But the anchor held. And that anchor is Jesus. That anchor is our hope that is in him. My hope's not in the boat. My hope's not in the waves. My hope's not in the sea. My hope's not in the other guy's boat. My hope's not in the commissioner of the sea who makes all the laws about boating. My hope is in my anchor. My hope is in the Lord. And no matter what goes on around me, the anchor holds. This is the hope of Jesus. This is the hope of Christianity. This is why the heroes of the faith lived lives infinitely worse than ours, mostly in worse poverty than us, clearly with less of the health benefits that we enjoy, with less of the freedoms than we. They just went through garbage their whole life, and they're heroes of the faith. Not because of how blessed they are, because God gave them a good deal on a new pair of jeans. Because no matter what life threw at them, their heart and soul and mind and their eyes were not just on the things of this world. They kept their eyes on Jesus. Church, we need to be reminded about the hope that we have. And the hope's not physical. And it's not in a politician. It's not in a vaccine. It's not in another season and everything being over. It's not in growing older and not having to deal with stuff anymore. It's not in what's behind us or before us. It's in Jesus. It's only in Jesus. Our hope's not in this world. Our hope's not in our healing. Our hope's not in provision. Our hope's not in the next miracle that God's going to do. Our hope is in the miracle he already did. When he gave his life on the cross and 3 days later, he came up out of that tomb. Our hope is in Jesus. Not just in what Jesus can do for us. Now listen, before you go off the deep end here, let me be very clear. I believe that our God heals. I believe that our God delivers. I believe that our God provides. I believe that our God is the God of miracles. I believe he can do more than we can ask or imagine. I believe that life with God is infinitely better than life without him. But even if Jesus didn't do anything for us, for the rest of our lives, we would still be in debt to him. And we could never do enough to earn his mercy and grace. It's not just who our hope is in. It's what our hope is in and what our hope isn't in. This is the promise of hope for you and I. It's not in situations. It's in a Savior who loves you so much. He came to this earth. He lived, he suffered, he died, and he rose again on the third day. If your hope is in anything else, that hope will fail you. But Jesus will never fail. Jesus will never fail. He's already won us the victory. I'll ask the worship team if they would come and join me as I wrap this up. I got one more verse I want to share with you, and it's the encouragement for you and I. So the two questions I asked you today were this. The first one, who do you put your hope in? The answer is Jesus, only Jesus. But what does that look like? When we say we're putting our hope in Jesus, what do you put your hope in? What does that really mean? It means that in the end, I will be with him. For eternity, I get to be with my Savior. And between now and then, no matter what this life throws my way, I will trust him. He will be with me no matter what I face. He'll be the anchor in every storm, in every success, in every failure, in every victory, in every defeat, and every mountaintop, and yes, in every valley. Jesus is with us. And I will honor him, and I will glorify him, and ultimately, in the end, I will be with him forever and ever. And there is nothing in this world, there is nothing of this world, there is nothing on the news, there is nothing in hell that can prevent that, because Jesus has broken every chain, and our hope and the hope that this world needs, our hope needs to be in him. This is my hope, that I will be with Jesus and that my eternity is secure with him. Anything good between now and then, it's just gravy. That's just a little whipped cream on top. I get to be with Jesus forever. That is our hope. That is the hope that we have. So Hebrews 10:23, and I'll close it with this. It's the NIV, I think. It says, now let us hold unswervingly to the hope that we profess. And that's my challenge. That's my admonition to you this morning. To hold unswervingly to the hope that you have in Jesus. Unswervingly, not being turned to one side or another, not swerving, not getting off path, not getting distracted with what's going on over here or what's going on over there, not losing hope because of this bad news or that bad news or more bad news or 24-hour bad news. Hold on unswervingly to that hope that we have, the anchor that can never be shaken, the rock that will stand secure for all time. Hold unswervingly to that faith that we profess. Hold on to that hope, but make sure it's the right hope. Make sure it's in Jesus and what he's promised us for all eternity. Would you bow your heads with me? I want to close with a word of prayer. I'll ask our altar team to join us up front here, and we'll close with some prayer and some worship. And I want to invite everyone just to come to the altar and spend time with Jesus. I think that's like the best part of service. I would invite you to get out of your seat and just come and give thanks to God and everything. But I specifically want to just speak to a couple people today. If you're here this morning and you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you might come to church, you might be, I don't know, religious, call yourself spiritual, but you don't have a relationship with Jesus, listen, he is our hope. He is the only one. He's the only thing. And I want you to know today, no matter who you are, we watched that little video in worship about Barabbas, no matter what you've done, no matter what your past or your story, Jesus loves you. He gave his life for you, and you can have hope for eternity because of him. If that's you today and you want to get your relationship with Jesus right, I would encourage you not to walk or run to this altar. There's people here who want to pray for you and make sure your life is right with Jesus. And there's other people in here today, you've been putting your hope in the wrong thing for a long time. And like the Jews, you were disappointed time after time after time when it didn't pan out. But your hope was never in Jesus. It was in good stuff happening to you. But I want you to know the best thing that ever happened to you is when God showed his love for you while you were still a sinner and he died on the cross for your sins. God has already given us hope. It's not hope in the temporal. It's not hope in things that are here today, gone tomorrow. It's not hope for just a better day. It's eternity. God has already given that to us. And some of you here today have had some misplaced hope. And maybe you just need to spend some time with Jesus and say, Father, forgive me and help me like these heroes of the faith, no matter what's going on around me, help me to keep my eyes on you. And if you're here today and you just need to spend some time with Jesus, you're going through a situation, a problem, there's people here would love to pray with you, would love to pray for you. So as the worship team comes and plays, let's stand together. Let me pray over you and let's spend some time with the Father before we leave. Lord, thank you for your word and thank you for how you love us and thank you for how you work in our lives. Thank you, God, that you never give up on us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that even when we're a mess, when we're a wreck, when we don't know which way is up and we don't know what we're going to do, God, you are still on the throne. You are still in control, and we can put all of our hope and our faith and our trust in you and you alone. Jesus, restore hope in your church. Lord, restore hope in those who have lost all hope. God, restore hope in those who have misplaced their hope. God, restore hope in the hopeless, the hope that we have only because of your Son, only because of the great love that you have for us. And Lord Jesus, let this church be a beacon of hope in a world, in a community that so desperately needs to know it. Lord, we thank you. We love you. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's respond to God this morning. Let's spend some time in his presence before we close.
The same.
trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before his throne. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone. We will faultless stand before.
Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, I don't care how you frame it, the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus. Now, that's too good, folks. That's too good. We should have planned that. Holy Spirit did. Our hope was built on nothing less than Jesus. Heavenly Father, we love you today. God, realign our thoughts, change our perspective, keep our eyes on you, and Lord, let us be beacons of hope in a dark world. Lord, a world that desperately needs you, let them find hope in us, in your church. Lord, despite adversity, despite trials, despite difficult seasons, God, our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. We love you. Be glorified in us, God. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Make sure to stop by a table. Find the place to serve.